What is going on and welcome back into Barley Studios. Who is ready for another awesome mastery class in YouTube thumbnail creation? Now in this video, we're going to be creating an awesome thumbnail for what, you may ask? Yes, it is Jigglypuff the acrylic painting. Now let's just jump straight into the content here, you guys. Now we're going to start off with a blank palette here in Procreate. Procreate is my favorite software to do any kind of thumbnail or really any kind of painting or digital art in. Now, as you can see here, we're going to start off this thumbnail by uploading two generic images here. One of me passed out on my desk. Okay, I may have posed. I might not be actually passed out by Jigglypuff. And then the other one is actually of the acrylic painting Jigglypuff itself. Now, as you can see here, the focus of this image, if you can't tell already, is going to be that little marker right there. We had created that little marker for Jigglypuff, microphone, as it were, out of Sculpey Original, and then we hand detail painted that. Now, that was all in the same content video, and I wanted to create just a really fun eye-popping thumbnail to go along with that. So what we're going to do here is we're going to begin by erasing the background on Jigglypuff image itself. This is a separate image because I wanted to make sure I could get two clear images of the individual items. The first focus is of course of Jigglypuff itself, and then the second focus is of me on the actual workstation or tabletop itself. Now you'll notice that I did decide throughout this process to keep my original kind of cutting mat on the workstation itself instead of making it like the nice stacked or patterned wood desk that I have from IKEA. It's like an actual like kitchen countertop. I decided to keep this nice grayed out with the white mesh measuring pattern on it. Now you can see it has a bunch of paint splotches and all sorts of things on it. I thought that it added a lot of character to that. Now, we are going to go ahead and remove the layer with Jigglypuff on it, and because we've already removed that background, but we're going to also leave me behind, and I'm going to erase the background. Now, we're going to leave the actual tabletop itself in the image, but when we adjust the saturation and the brightness of me on the tabletop, it will adjust the actual tabletop gray tone as well. So, the gray matte, we'll just refer to it as the gray matte moving forward. That's what will be changed also. So, we want to make sure it kind of just looks fun and uniform. All right, with that background removed, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and duplicate the previous image. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep that existing shop background or my studio background there. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of perspective blur that towards my image here. So it's an overlay of the same image, but one of those layers, the layer on top, has the background removed. So I can really kind of tinker with and remove or add the background as I see fit. I really do like the overall color of the left side of that background, but I think the right hand side is just kind of blah. That's one thing about my studio currently, is that I have a really nice work desk and station, but the background is just kind of like a storage slash crafting room, and it's really not really designed to be on screen very much. You'll see here I went ahead and added the original background for the entire Jigglypuff series here. Now you can see that throughout the entire YouTube thumbnail creation videos for all of the Jigglypuff thumbnails that I've made, or at least those that I have uploaded. And what we're going to do here is I'm going to change the saturation and the brightness of me on the mat itself on my countertop. I was thinking about really kind of changing my dimension there in the screen, but I decided not to, just because if I adjust one layer, then it leaves one layer behind me not adjusted. We're going to go ahead and use the eraser tool with just a lowered opacity, and I'm just going to gently remove a little bit of the background there. Now, I'm really going to focus on removing more of the right-hand side. The whole white door and the white wall behind me just wasn't sitting well, but I did kind of like how like the bright left-hand side looked. It just looked very fun and bright, and it has fairy lights and Christmas lights and really colorful lights on my workstation in the studio, but Jigglypuff almost covers that up. So this kind of idea just kind of evolved over time, and you'll see that I kind of blink in and out of the background over time, just deciding if I want to just make it straight up the original background that I used for the Jigglypuff series. So right now I'm just kind of deciding and arguing with myself internally whether I want to make Jigglypuff a little bit smaller, whether I want her ears to kind of cascade off of the image itself, or her arms and legs to kind of cascade off the left-hand side, how much of the background that she's actually going to cover, the angle that I would like for her to be at. I want a little bit of the background to be visible, but I also want me to be visible, but I also want the mat to be visible. everything has to have its own space, and it has to look uniform in some ways. So I'm really kind of debating this throughout this entire process. I even contemplated like flipping myself or removing portions of the background and leaving some aspects of it in, some aspects of it out. And this is part of the creation process. Now, this is a little bit more intense of a thumbnail creation video than some of the previous ones, just because there's a lot of aspects to it that I kind of wanted to throw into it. And I really wanted, for the most part, a thumbnail in the series at some point of me kind of like put to sleep on my workstation. I just had it in my mind and I wanted to introduce that. Now, I am going to go ahead and tinker with the Jigglypuff, her arm, and how it's kind of shaped and how it's holding the microphone. So to do this, what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and upload a separate image of the microphone itself. I just felt like the microphone that the original image was holding was just simply too small, and there was not enough detail showing in the actual microphone itself. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to upload a separate image here, and we're going to doctor it a little bit so that way we can make the image slightly larger. And it can be more of an eye pull on the canvas itself. So what we're going to do here is the goal is whether your eye is pulled to Jigglypuff or me or the microphone, the end result is that the microphone will be the middle of this thumbnail, and then that is what this YouTube video is about. We are creating this microphone, whether you understand it's out of clay, whether you understand it's hand-painted, whatever you understand is, you see Jigglypuff, you know that Jigglypuff probably has a microphone, and you know that I'm passed out in the background. Now, yes, I know I'm just passed out right now, but we're going to doctor my face here in a little while, and we're going to add some fun and just intricate ways into it. I'm going to erase a little bit of the original microphone from Jigglypuff's hand so that way I can kind of angle the microphone the way that I would like to. I also go ahead and select that layer for the microphone, and I up the saturation quite a bit and increase the brightness just slightly. And that just makes that green top a little bit more vibrant, and it makes it pop a little bit more against the background so that it just draws the eye a little bit more. The contrast is extremely important, and you can see that it really is drawing the eye a lot more. You can see how, like, before it was just kind of like rinky dink in the background in her hand. Now it's really brought forward. It's really kind of in the middle of the image, and it's easy to see now. Now I'm going to go ahead and do a little bit of color matching here, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of apply just a general shadow. So we're just going to apply just a regular paintbrush here. I think that it's a marker, I believe I selected. I can't remember. And what we're going to do is we're just going to lower the occupancy on a pink to dark color, and we're going to apply a shadow here. We'll also go into that layer, and we will Gaussian blur that ever so slightly, and it makes it look like Jigglypuff is standing on the work surface, and the microphone has its own individual shadow on the surface as well. That is something that is extremely simple, but adding that one layer with that shadow and a Gaussian blur ups the level of the overall image and makes it feel less 2D. Obviously, the canvas itself is very flat, and we didn't want to have that all by itself, just kind of out there blatantly by itself. It looks more complete with that shadow. All right, so at this point, what I'm thinking about doing is I'm going to start marking up my face. Now, in the animated series, anytime Jigglypuff sang her song and then people have fallen asleep around her, she gets extremely upset and frustrated because people can never listen to her song all the way through. And what she'll do is she'll use her infamous marker, which we kind of sculpted into the microphone, and she will mark up their face. I thought it would be very cool to mark up my own face for one of these thumbnails, and that's what I've been talking about kind of off and on throughout this thumbnail creation video, is I wanted to mark up my own face. Now, I am using a few of the old reference photos from the animated series, and I'm just going to kind of introduce different aspects of some of those little drawings with her marker that she uses, whether it's be reference photos off of Google or just things off the animated series. And I'm just going to kind of tinker with and see if I can find some that I like that don't look too like generic and cartoonish and just kind of crummy, but just add little fun things to my face to just be like, yeah, he must have fell asleep during her song. And it just adds a little fun characteristic to the actual thumbnail itself. Little tongue there. I'm like, I don't know if I like that or not. Tinkering with the Gaussian blur to see if I blurred it, would it look more like a marker? Not really. I don't know if I even want to keep the eyebrows and the circle and the mustache that I have there. And this is just a back and forth type of thing. Adding things like this to your thumbnail just ups the ante a little bit, but it does add quite a bit of more time to the overall process. So zooming in a little bit here, just deciding what I would like to do, I do go ahead and erase some of that. And now I'm kind of just tinkering with just different brushes to see if I can create more of a just a natural kind of marker look. I felt the other one was a little bit too grainy. So we apply just a little bit different color tones here. So we will also remove some of this color by using the eraser tool. We will lower the opacity of that eraser tool, and we will kind of erase slight variations here and there where the marker may apply less pressure in particular areas. So if like Jigglypuff were to really mark on my face, then it would probably change the pressure as she marks on my face, so like around the bridge of the nose, around the beard line, around the edge of the bridge of my nose and on the underside. It would be less marker there possibly, or it'd be less visible. So it's very important to erase slight areas here and soften those hard edges, so that way it just kind of blends a little bit better with my existing skin tone. It's not really noticeable when you're like really zoomed all the way out, but the overall finished effect really picks up quite well on that. It's something small, it's probably not necessary, but I think that it adds a little bit of characteristic to it, just like the overall shadow under Jigglypuff helps with the image. Going to go into the Jigglypuff image and kind of adjust the saturation and the brightness to see if I can get it to contrast even better with my background there and me on the mat there. Just tinkering with some of the layers to see if I can get it to overall look a little bit different. And I was also contemplating changing the overall size of me in the background, but I kind of really didn't do that a whole lot. I felt like it was just, I was just trying too hard here. So I did kind of tinker with it to see if I wanted to change it, but I tend to keep it the way that it was for the most part. I think I make it a little bit larger here, but it's just microscopic, and it's nothing that's going to like be like, that changes everything. So after adjusting the saturation and the brightness on myself there, I did come out slightly darker there, just so I'm not pulling too much of the eye in the image in general. And what we're going to do is here, so I'm going to erase a little bit of the background there a little bit at a time until I can kind of get the overall look that I want. As I work through this process, I'm finding that I dislike the overall fact that I will use the background to go over the existing studio background, like the door and my shelvings and the wall. And I find that I feel like it just pulls too much eye and it makes it a little bit messy. So I do go ahead and remove that and make it a pure doctored background that we've used through the entire Jigglypuff series. I think it brings up the level of pop a little bit. So we're going to enter this into Canva here. And what we're going to do is we're going to overlay the existing thumbnail creation here in Canva. We're going to upload this image here. And what we'll do is we're going to go ahead and overlay that onto the existing image. And what we'll do is we'll use the same font and the same intensity in the effects of that font. And what we'll do is we'll doctor that to say what we want. Now, throughout this last portion of this content video here, I will be using the font feature here to create not one, not two, but three individual thumbnails. Now, of course, they're going to say different things, and what I'm really testing on is whether too much font is too much font. So what I'll do is I'll kind of adjust it to say one or two things, and I'll kind of layer those in different sizes. And when I get the A, B, and C thumbnail testing feature in YouTube, then I will kind of be able to back test some of those features, whether it's better just to have no font at all, something similar, just the medium, or just say like microphone, Jigglypuff mic, things like that. So we'll kind of tinker with it to see if just creating just simplistic words or maybe two or three words increases the overall click-through rate. And that's really the fun part of the analytics of YouTube, is being able to test your artistic style and creation against the algorithm there. So you can always adapt and change. And that's really supposed to be the fun challenge of YouTube, is that you're not, we're not like some big production studio with like hundreds of people that can have like data analysts and content creators and writers and producers. We're usually a one person show. So we make the content, we create the thumbnails, we do the advertising. Yeah, the analytics and the algorithm does take over a little bit, but it's our content that YouTube is pushing out to people. And having control over some of this stuff is really the fun challenge of YouTube. And I think that some people get burnt out on YouTube, but as long as you think of YouTube as just a fun hobby, and just imagine that it's just like a challenge every day to enjoy, then that's the most important thing in creating for YouTube. And again, that's what a lot of these thumbnail creation videos is for, is not just it allows me to create some more content here for my art channel, but it also allows you to kind of see different ways that I create thumbnails. So if you like my overall thumbnail style and you have Procreate on your iPad, then you can create something similar for your channel. And hopefully you'll subscribe and like the video as well. Don't forget, as we enter into this is more of a real-time portion of the video where I'm kind of editing and changing the overall color of the font, the size, where it's positioned. I really feel like, as you can see here, Jigglypuff's microphone, the two words, Jigglypuff's microphone, I feel like that's too much. So when you zoom all the way out, it's really too small. It doesn't eye pop. Now, yes, it has good contrast against that dark, fun background that we use, but it really doesn't have that vibrancy that I need, and the wording comes out too small. I feel like the words Jigglypuff microphone is far too long by themselves. Now, if I could get away with probably just having Jigglypuff on there, yeah, but Jigglypuff's microphone is too much. As you can see at the very bottom right-hand corner, I can put just Clay and point to the microphone there, and that portrays that is Jigglypuff's microphone out of Clay. I just feel like it needs to be really easy to understand, even at a fully zoomed out version of the overall thumbnail. So as I said before, we'll create a few of these here, and then we'll kind of wrap everything up by just uploading this into YouTube itself, the YouTube studio. So we'll kind of just tinker with it here and there. As you can see, like I put at the top here, Clay mic. I know that the C on the mic is almost hard to read a little bit because it wants to, it almost looks like it's closing over to an O. So Clay Mio, Mayo, Clay Mayo. But the wording is slightly larger, and because it has less syllables, it's easier to read. So if somebody were to be scrolling through YouTube and they saw this thumbnail, all the images in the thumbnail kind of draw the eye, but then at the top it says Clay, like Clay Mike, and it points to the microphone, you know that the video is about the microphone and that it's made out of clay. So you assume that I would be sculpting or creating that out of that element. So clay would be it. I really think that just having the simplistic words at the top is just the easiest way to portray what the video is about. And then if somebody's interested in either of these things, Clay Creations and mics, or either a singer or into Pokemon or to painting, then they may find their way into the video itself. But I'll try to make it to where the wording is very simplistic and we don't overthink it too much. So we're going to go ahead and upload all of these images here, and we're going to kind of just tinker with the overall font and the wording a little bit more to create those other three images there before we hop over into the YouTube studio. Now, I know that the last portion of this video was kind of long, but I just want to kind of portray the fact that I do try to keep my wording kind of small and simplified. Look how great that looks, you guys. Now, I do have a lot of those, so we'll upload some more later. Make sure you like, subscribe, and check out the playlist. Later, guys.